Hello and welcome to the 9th part of developing with the Bitwig API, and this time we will look into how you develop with Java. Until now we develop with JavaScript, and it has several disadvantages to use JavaScript, but what are the advantages if you switch over to Java? There are several. For example, Java is a type language and there are many tools you can get for it. So Java is one of the most popular programming languages, so you get all the things like IDEs, code analyzers and whatsoever. And the biggest option to switch over, I guess, is the option to debug. If you ever try to find a bug in your JavaScript and had to deal with print lines, you will absolutely love that, to have a proper debugger which helps you finding your bugs in your code. And then you get tool support like code completion, which improves the development massively. You have full access to the Java API and you can integrate nearly any library you want. You get, so if you get the tons of additional libraries for Java, for example document indexers, search engines or whatever you can think of and want to put into such an extension. And you could also not only use Java, you can basically use any language which compiles to Java bytecode. I did not try that, but I cannot think of anything why this should not work. For example, you could use Groovy, and you have also via the JNI interface you have the option to include C or C++ code, which could also be helpful in some areas, for example if you want to address specific hardware. So what do you need to do to Java? So the disadvantage is it takes a bit of tooling to keep you going. You cannot just have simply only a text editor and write your JavaScript like we did before. You need to have first a Java development kit, and you should use definitely version 1.8 because this is the one still used in Bitwig. So we only need the JDK as a compiler, so to compile our code and package it in a jar file. I have not tested, but also the OpenJDK 1.8 should work fine. And the second tool you need is Apache Maven, because that's the build tool that is used by Bitwig. This helps you a lot getting additional libraries, including libraries, checking versions of libraries and these things. So it helps you in your software engineering quite a bit, and it's very easy to install. You just go to the Apache website of Maven and just say you want to download here the zip file, unzip it to anywhere you like onto your hard disk, and you're basically ready to go. But you should add both the Java and also the Maven in your environment path. So for example on Windows you have here your environment variables, and you should have set the Java home variable here to the JDK 1.8. and if you look at the path, you should have here the Java home of the bin, so we can directly run Java from a command line. And you should also have your Apache directory which you unzipped also with the bin folder in there in your path. And if you update it, you at least need to log off here on Windows to make this work. So if you open up now a command line, you should be able to type, for example, Java dash minus version, and you should get the correct version, the 1.81, in case you have installed multiple Java versions. And also for Maven, the main program is MVN, and with minus V you also can get the version. So this should also turn up nicely. So if you have that, you're basically ready to go to write and compile code for Java. You don't need an IDE yet, but this will help you quite a lot. For example, you have the possibility to debug your Java code. We can also use the same tool to create our new project. So last time we selected JavaScript, but this time we will go with Java, and you will see most of the settings are identical. So the name and vendor and author version is the same, but we will get some additional parameters here as well. But for here, for the upper part, we will use the same stuff as before. So here we will have Yamaha Mox F. So the idea is to do the same as we did before, but convert this to Java now for this Mox F example. Now only Mox F, and the vendor will be Yamaha here. And the author is again me for that. And we start with version 1.0. We need one MIDI input and one MIDI output, as we have done before. And as a location, I created here already a folder called API tutorial for that. And now you see we have some more options here. You can give the class file the name for your main class. So here it's only called MoxF. Maybe let's call that MoxF extension. And the package name, this normally suggests if you do Java that you use your domain name in a different order, so from the end to the start. I will go with my homepage domain, and the Maven group ID and the Maven artifact ID is basically pretty the same like here, but it's used by Maven to identify the artifact, so the software or jar or library or whatever you create. And this is if you have multiple artifacts in that development code, then this is the group. So you can use your package name in here. You can use again the name from your main class. So this will keep you going. So we are ready to click OK. And if we then go to the directory, you will see also again we have such a MoxF folder created, which contains our source code and such a POM file. This POM file is the definition file for Maven, which makes a set up for this build environment and tells Maven what to do. So if we open up the source folder, you see there is a main folder and there is a Java folder and resources. This is because of Maven requires a specific structure in which you structure the elements of your project, and I will not explain all that. Please read that up in the Maven documentation, but normally you don't have to change anything. Only have to know that your source code files are located in this Java folder, and if you need any resources, for example like images, you should put that into this resources folder. And if we look into that, finally you will see that we created two files for us. Before, we only with JavaScript we only had one file which contained everything, but here we have two. One is the extension itself and the other one is the definition, which contains all the information, for example about the author and the naming and these things. Before we look into the code, we will first have a look at this POM file, what this actually does. If we open up that here in our editor, you will see this is written in XML and there is some gobbledygook here which we don't care about, but what is important, you will see here this group idea and this artifact is created here, which we put into this dialog, and it also says the final packaging will be a jar file, the name is MoxF and our version is 0.1. So here you need to increase the version if you release a new one. If you compile the first time, Maven will look up here this repositories you have. So if it's looking for a dependency, which you see down there, we have a dependency to the Bitwig API. So the Bitwig API is also now referenced with such a group ID, an artifact, and also a version number. So this means here we have this version number 7. So you remember in a JavaScript we had this load API function in the beginning, which said we want to support version 7. And if you do that here with Maven now and Java, you also need to change this in your POM file so that Maven downloads the correct library from this Bitwig public Maven server. For example, if you want to integrate other Java libraries, you might need to integrate other repositories here as well, for example like the central Maven repository. Finally, the build says okay, we include such a Maven plugin, which is a compiler plugin. So this is actually the Java compiler. It makes some settings for you. For example, it says the source code and target compilation code is Java 1.8 and the encoding is UTF-8 and some memory setting which you don't need to care about. This is now finally interesting. Java is always packaged in jar files, so the output here is a jar file and it will be renamed to something like BW extension. So this will always be the file which you put into Bitwig, which means if you have multiple jar files, for example you integrate libraries from other sources, you need to put them all into a big jar file and give that the extension of BW extension. There's also a Maven plugin which is called the shade plugin, which does that for you, so you also don't have to take care about that one. Only remember, if you have multiple jar files, shade them into one big BW extension file. Another thing you see is that we have here some properties. So this means that the file is expected in a project build directory and it will also copy it into the build directory. So we still need to copy our result to Bitwig. For our first run, this is nice, but normally if you run such a build process, you would want to have it straight released to Bitwig, because Bitwig then will also automatically reload your extension. It does it for you and this will speed up your development process massively, because because you don't have to copy all the time this new file to Bitwig to test a new version. So we already are ready to have such a compile run. So if you navigate inside your mocsf folder, so back to here, we created here this mocsf. Let's go inside this part here. You can now compile with Maven your source code. So what you need to type is mvn and then the install command. This will basically do everything that is necessary to come up if you have a final char. And as you see, first thing that Maven does, if you never run Maven, it will also download the compiler and all these things. So this might take some time, and you definitely need the internet connection to do that. And you see we succeeded. If we look now in this folder, you will see there will be now a new folder created, which is a target folder, which contains all that stuff that Maven created and compiled. And you have the option to remove all that stuff. If you don't want to have that clutter on your hard disk, you can then always say Maven clean, and then this target will simply be deleted and you're back to only having your source code there. And you can run the previous command again to do the compilation and end up with all those files. So if we look into the target, you will see the main output is here this char file, but it got renamed to this mocsf extension, bw extension. And what we need to do is to provide that to Bitwig, but I forgot something, because we will have now the same naming as with the JavaScript version, but I wanted to keep the JavaScript version as well. So let's open up that here and rename our mocsf to, let's say here, it's mocsf java. And while we're at it here, let's have a look at this definition. So the definition does the same thing as we did before in a JavaScript with this define command. So if we compare this to the JavaScript, we had this define controller command, which gave these different parameters. And this is basically what is the content of this extension definition file. There you will see the UID here up there. And then you will have the name, the author, the version, and this returns this static idea, the hardware vendor, and so on and so on. Also here, this is a very important function, because here instead of saying a load API 7, we have now here this function called get required API version, which returns number 7. So if you change the supported API version, you need to change it here and also in the POM file where I showed you before. And it contains also your configuration for the MIDI port. So what we had here, the define MIDI ports 1.1 is now done. Also here is a callback function here. It's for the input and for the output. And this here is a function which gives a suggestion for the auto detection. So what we did here with that line is now done here in that function. Okay, that's already the definition file. And now let's recompile it back to here with our change name. And this worked as well. So let's go to the target folder. There is our BW extension. And now let's look into the Bitwig folder. You've seen previously, if you go into extensions folder, you see I already have my driven by MOS extension here. And this is also the place where we'll put now here the mocsf extension. And let's see what happens in Bitwig. If we go now here to the controllers page again, we will see. You will see not, because it's down there. Let's move it up a bit. Okay, I cannot make it show for you, but nevertheless, it turned up and you will see it's here mocsf java. This is also available. Let's turn off the JavaScript here up there, and you will see it will turn up as well and also give you the information we entered into this script. Finally, let's have a look at the actually extension which was created. So the definition file was pretty straightforward, I think. And let's also have a look at the second created. And if you look at this extension function, you will see that this extension extends a controller extension and calls here just a superclass. And we have again, like previously with JavaScript, we have our init function, we have our exit function, and we have the flush function. This is pretty identical. And And also with the previously code generation, with JavaScript, we get the code generation for a MIDI callback and for a SysX callback. And this is the same. We will get some notifications about exit and init. And in init, we also have the same example code. We get the host. So the host is now not available as a global variable. Instead, we have to call this getHost function and have here also the host object then. And there is some example code here as well. So next time we will look how you can use an IDE, use clips for that, and after that we will transform our JavaScript code to this Java extension. And until, write some funky code!